Good morning. St. Anthony of Padua's parish family welcomes all who have gathered for our liturgy for the 29th Sunday of Ordinary Time. You are kindly requested at this time to turn off all electronic devices, including cell phones. This weekend, we celebrate World Mission Sunday. We are invited to reflect on our personal relationship with Christ and how we share the gospel in prayer and action. We are mindful, too, of all the missionaries in mission territories who sacrifice their lives to serve their most in need. May the Holy Spirit dwell in them and in us as we pray for our sisters and brothers throughout the world. This liturgy is being offered for the happy repose and soul of Daniel Finelli. Altar flowers are in memory of John Merlow. We begin our prayer by standing and joining in singing number 613, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven, number 613.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Good morning. We gather together as a parish family to celebrate these sacred mysteries. As we prepare to do so, we call to mind our sins, asking the Lord's mercy and forgiveness. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done, and what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to me. You, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son,
the right hand of the Father,
have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ. When the Holy Spirit in the
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, grant that we may always conform our will to yours and serve your majesty in sincerity of heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
The readings can be found at number 1176, number 1176.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed Cyrus, whose right hand I grasp, subduing nations before him and making kings run in his service, opening doors before him and leaving the gates unbarred. For the sake of Jacob, my servant, of Israel, my chosen one, I have called you by your name, giving you a title, though you knew me not. I am the Lord, there is no other. There is no God besides me. It is I who arm you, though you know me not, so that toward the rising and setting of the sun, people may know that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, there is no other. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The antiphon to the psalm can be found at number 67. Sing glory. nations the Lord is King, who rules with justice. Give the Lord glory and honor. Give the Lord glory and honor.
Beginning of the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy to the Church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace. We give thanks to God always for all of you, remembering you in our prayers, unceasingly calling to mind your work of faith and labor of love and endurance, in hope of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before God and Father, knowing, brothers and sisters loved by God, how you were chosen, for our gospel did not come to you in word alone, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit with much conviction. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
The Pharisees went off and plotted how they might entrap Jesus in speech. They sent their disciples to him with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are a truthful man and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. And you're not concerned with anyone's opinion, for you do not regard a person's status. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it lawful to pay the census tax to Caesar or not?" Knowing their malice, Jesus said, "Why are you testing me, you hypocrites? Show me the coin that pays the census tax." Then they handed him the Roman coin. He said to them, "Whose image is this? And whose inscription?" They replied, "Caesar's." At that, he said to them, "Then repay to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I always feel like this is the modern example of the mic drop, you know? Jesus gives this answer to a seemingly impossible question. If he would have said, give to Caesar, then the Jewish people who were following him would say, look, you're aligning your life with these Roman pagans. And if he says, no, give to God, not to Caesar, oh, you're disobeying the Roman law. And so really, basically the Pharisees and the Herodians thought they really jammed Jesus up. And whatever he says, we got him. And then all of a sudden, he gives this answer, and he goes much above that. So in case anyone's wondering, too, I've heard this say once, is it lawful? Father, do I have to pay taxes? Yes. Jesus is saying, yes, you have to pay taxes, okay? I came across this reflection. With this reply, Jesus places himself above the controversy. On the one hand, he acknowledges that the tribute to Caesar must be paid because the image on the coin is Caesar's. But above all, he recalls that each person carries within him another image. We carry it in the heart and in the soul, that of God. And therefore, it is to him and to him alone that each person owes his own existence, his own life. In other words, you see the image of Caesar, so we pay to Caesar. But whose image is Caesar created in? Think Genesis. Who are you and I created in? The image and likeness of God. So Jesus is giving like a dual layout. He said, yeah, you have to take care and give on the secular level, but you also have to give back to God what is God's. And so he doesn't put this either or category. He kind of prioritizes in a certain sense. I love this. This is an ancient commentary on the scripture. The image of God is not impressed on gold, but on the human race. Caesar's coin is gold. God's coin is humanity. Therefore, give your riches to Caesar, but keep for God the unique innocence of your conscience. Caesar, in fact, asked that his image be on every coin. But God chose man and woman whom he created to reflect his glory. Another quote was this from a church father. I love this. Where is it at? There it is. To each, he says, must be given what belongs to him. For it teaches that authority is twofold, having an earthly and a human aspect, a heavenly and a divine aspect. This parable teaches that we owe a twofold duty of obedience to human laws and to the law of God. The coin bearing Caesar's likeness and inscription must be given to Caesar, and the one stamped with the divine image and likeness must be given to God. Hence, the mission of the church is to speak of God and bear witness to him to the men and women of our time. Each one of you, each one of us, by baptism is called to be a living presence of God in society, inspiring it with the gospel and with the lifeblood of the Holy Spirit. Our discipleship, our growing, is a question of committing ourselves with humility and at the same time with courage, making one's own contribution to building the civilization of love, where justice and fraternity reign. In other words, we celebrate this mission Sunday, and we often think of missionaries or those people that are sent to foreign lands. But by the nature of our faith, we are all missionaries. The last words of every Mass are what? Stay and hang around for coffee, right? No, it's a command. Go, go. It's the same word that Jesus uses at the end of the gospel when he tells his disciples, go into all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them all that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always until the end of the age. In other words, in God's plan, each and every one of you have a unique mission in this world. You have God's image stamped on you. You are made in the image and likeness of God. And being a follower of Christ, by being a disciple of Christ, you are to reflect that image. And part of being a follower of Christ is to allow the image of God to radiate more and more in us. And so that becomes a question. Does my life radiate Jesus? Or does it shadow Jesus or cover Jesus or become an anti-sign? And so on this World Mission Sunday, when we think about that, we are reminded of our dignity, that each and every one of you have a unique dignity because you are created in the image and likeness of God. And therefore, that's kind of in a certain sense, in a broader sense, everyone is created in the image and likeness of God. And so we must treat each person with that dignity. Not easy. But more specifically, in a deeper way, as disciples of Jesus, as followers of Christ, we have a unique command to go into the world and to reflect Jesus, the life of God, by our words and our actions. And that's why the church tells us to come to Mass each week, because if we try to do that, it's hard. And sometimes we do it and sometimes we don't. And so we come back to together as a community. We come to listen to the word of God. We come to be challenged and to be fed both intellectually in our minds, in our spirits, and we're given supernatural food. Jesus says, "This is my body given for you." So we receive Jesus' body in our body. And then we leave these four walls equipped as members of the body of Christ, Christ living in us, and we're to bring that to others. Let me just put a little commentary on the first reading. Do you know who Cyrus is? You know, if you Google Cyrus, you know who comes up? Miley. Who's that? Cyrus was he's an actual historical figure. He was the king of Persia about 500 years before the time of Jesus. And Cyrus was the new emperor of the new Persian Empire that had conquered the Babylonian Empire of Nebuchadnezzar, who had conquered Israel and carried off the Jews into exile and the slavery in Babylon. That's amazing. You're all looking like, what are you talking about? It's hard for us because that's not our history. But what it's saying is that Cyrus was a pagan emperor, okay? And what happens is let's go back a little bit. God's chosen people, Israel, the Israelites, Babylon Empire came over and overtook them. They invaded the Holy Land and took them captive, okay? And they removed them from their land. And they lived in exile for close to 70 years. And what happens is this other empire, the Persian Empire, run by King Cyrus, overtakes Babylon. And what happens is King Cyrus actually writes a decree that tells the Israelites that they can return to the promised land, to their land, the area of Jerusalem. Does that sound familiar? This land has always been volatile. But it was Cyrus who freed the Jews and restored their homeland to them. This is in the first reading, which is from the prophet Isaiah. And throughout the Old Testament, one of the main things we're driven home is that we hear God say, "I am the Lord and there is no other. There is no other God beside me." And so that's the constant teaching of the Old Testament, is that there is one God, not multiple gods. All the other gods are idols. There is one God. You know, in the Jewish practice, there is the beautiful prayer of the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is one. And in the New Testament, we discover that this one God is not a solitary being, but rather what we call a communion of persons. There's relationship in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This one God, is revealed in the New Testament, is the God of love. Not the God of love, God who is love. And so that's the point being drilled home. And so here's this quote that I came across. "Just as Cyrus, who was the king of Persia, did not know the true God, yet the true God used him for a much larger purpose for all of Israel. So God used Israel
even though most of Israel did not know Jesus Christ, for the sake of a much larger audience than Israel, for Christ's redemption of the whole world. In other words, God uses Cyrus for Israel. He uses Israel for the preparation of Jesus Christ, and he gives Jesus Christ for the whole world. Thus, Cyrus's importance is worldwide. Does this make sense a little bit? Like, I'm reading this quote 50 times. I'm like, this is awesome. That's why God says to Cyrus in the first reading today, "It is I who arm you, though you knew me not, so that toward the rising and the setting of the sun, people may know that there is none beside me." God used the life of Cyrus in a pivotal way that Cyrus didn't even realize. God can use his life, he can use our lives in ways that sometimes we don't even realize. See, the book of Isaiah that we're hearing, the reading today, is telling us that God is one. There is no other. There are no other gods other than the Lord. And even the powerful Cyrus, emperor of the Persian, was part of the larger plan that God alone knew and carried ahead. This reading here gives us a deep theological meaning of history. This is the quote I came across. This sounds so nerdy. "The epochal upheavals and the succession of great powers are under the supreme domination of God. No earthly power can stand in his stead." Let's translate that very simply. God is in charge of every detail. God has a plan. In a certain sense, we can say it this way. It can't really be thwarted. This is a mystery here because we can't wrap our heads around it. God is so far beyond our understanding. But what I'm trying to show is that God used the life of Cyrus, and he wasn't even realizing it in his bigger plan. Do you ever think about your own life? Do you know if your parents never met, you wouldn't exist? Did you know that? But let's think of if your great-grandparents never met, you wouldn't exist. If your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandparents didn't exist and meet, guess what? You would never exist. Think about that. Your life is a gift and part of God's plan from the beginning. And he wants to use your life. He wants to use your life. He's created you uniquely. There's no one in the world like you. And he wants us to come to know him. He wants us to know that we are loved by him, and he wants us to trust him. And that sounds so easy in the church, but the daily living of trust is hard. And that's what God wants of us. He wants us to trust him in even the most darkest moments. That line that says that even in all, there's no earthly power can stand in his stead. We can get worked up about events in the world, the war in Ukraine, what's going on in Israel, the different events in our own country. Sometimes we read about the politics of the church and what is the Pope doing, or what about this, or what about this bishop? Or we can get overwhelmed by the circumstances of our lives, something in our family, a health concern, someone in our family gets arrested, someone in our family is sickly, our relationship goes south. These are real sorrows, real pains, real difficulties. So I'm not denying them. But we have to rely on our faith in God, that God is in control. And what gives us stability is that trust. God, I can't figure this out. I don't know how this is going to work out. But you know. Help me to trust you. Help me to trust you. So that's when we come to church each week, is to remind us that the God of the universe has a plan. The God of the universe calls each and every one of you to participate in that plan in a unique way by reflecting the image of God in your words and in your actions. And sometimes life seems overwhelming, and even sometimes our life can be a quote-unquote shipwreck. We're upset about choices we've made. But this is the mystery of God. God can take the most difficult and worst event in the whole world and transform it for good. Our hope is in the cross here. Jesus knows suffering. He knows pain. He knows abandonment. He knows the experience of every human sin without committing it. He knows the struggles. And he takes it onto himself. And our God says, I'm with you. I can transform it. My love is more powerful than any sin, any suffering, and even death itself. And that love is made present on this altar. And that God, the God of the universe, who created the whole world, who called King Cyrus, and who in Jesus spoke to the Pharisees, is made present here today on this altar to be with you. If that's not good news, I don't know what is. Never give up and know that our Lord is with us. And ask the Lord today, who might I be able to reflect your image to this week? And if you ask that sincerely, the Lord will show you, and it'll give you a little sense that you are part of God's plan. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, with the Father and the Son is ruled and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism, forgiveness of sins. Let us ask our God to hear our prayers and petitions on behalf of those who are in need.
For the Pope, bishops, and priests, may they inspire in all the people the desire for a true relationship with Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our renewed commitment of the world's leaders to peace and justice for all God's children, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God's people may be active in carrying out their civic responsibilities and may choose leaders who build a society that respects all human life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the faithful living out their call to mission, may the celebration of World Mission Sunday make all Christians aware that they are not only recipients, but also proclaimers of the Word of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of our parishes, that God may continue to bless us, keep us, and help us to grow together as one Christian community. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in our community who are lonely, sick, and suffering, may God shower them with his love and compassion. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially Daniel Finelli, and are recently deceased, that they may be purified of sin and welcomed into the glory of heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the intentions we hold close to our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father, hear the prayers of your people and bring comfort to all who are in need. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. As we offer our gifts to the Father, we join in singing number 592, We Are the Light of the World, number 592.
Blessed are they who are poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of God. so, Lord, make us poor in spirit. Bless us, O Lord, our God. We are the light of the world. May our light shine before all, that they may see the good that we do and give glory to God. Blessed are they. Bless us, O Lord, make us meek and humble. Bless us, O Lord, our God. We are the light of the world. May our light shine before all, that they may see the good that we do and give glory to God. Blessed are they who will mourn in sorrow, they will be comforted. Bless us, O Lord, when we share their sorrow. Bless us, O Lord, our God. We are the light of the world. May our light shine.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Grant us, Lord, we pray, a sincere respect for your gifts, that through the purifying action of your grace we may be cleansed by the very mysteries we serve, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, always, everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundation of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so, with all the angels, we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice,
may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord, of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with Saint Anthony and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Alfred, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress. So we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
As we come forward to receive Jesus, we join in singing number 777, Here I Am, Lord, number 777.
Say, I, Lord.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that benefiting from participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what you give in this present age and prepared for the gifts that are eternal. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle.
Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil.
May God rebuke him, we humbly pray.
And to thou, O Prince of the heavenly hosts,
by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Members of the Holy Name will be in the vestibule selling their lottery tickets for the month of December. Tickets are only $5. Next Saturday morning, October 28th at 9 a.m., there will be a showing of a film on Pope Francis's letter on the environment. It will be in the St. Bernard Room at the Parish Center of Our Lady of Mercy. Please see the bulletin for more information. On Tuesday, November 7th, the Mass book will open for intentions for Masses in 2024. Please see the bulletin for guidelines on Mass intentions. Renewed in faith, we go forth singing number 578, How Great Thou Art, number 578.